Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to now call this evening's meeting of the Planning Commission to order. Before we begin, please note that this meeting is being video recorded and streamed live to the internet. May I have a confirmation of posting and roll call?
Chair Bokelman, the agenda has been posted according to the Nevada Open Meeting Law. All commissioners are present.
Thank you. Will everyone please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Staff, are there any changes to the agenda?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. The following changes and memorandums have been included in the backup documentation. Item number one, the Planning Commission minutes. Please note there's a correction under the staff present portion of the minutes to add Brandon Kemble as the Assistant City Attorney. Item number two, Strongbox Bermuda. The project name should be Strongbox Bermuda as indicated on the tentative map exhibit. Item number 8B for Rainbow Canyon at Lake Las Vegas. On page 17 of the staff's report, the word weather has been deleted so that the findings read as statements and not questions. Item number 18 for Lake Moore, a vacation and abandonment. This item will be heard out of order and introduced with the other Lake Moore items, number 3, 4, and 5. Item number 19, WDA El Dorado Valley. Benton Knight Street is misspelled on the exhibits. The exhibits provided to City Council will reflect the correct spelling. Item number 20 for Black Mountain Ranch, master sign application. There's a memo addressing and adding the findings of fact. Item number 21E, Avia Inspirata Retail Center. There's a memo adding the Clark County Department of Aviation conditions and comments. Item number 27 for the sign package for Atwell Suites. There's a memo adding the findings of fact and the applicant's requested modifications to the conditions section of the staff report. We also have the following items that are being requested for continuance or withdrawal. Staff recommends continuance of all the items as noted. Item number six, tentative MAC for Project Parlay. This is continued to the July 11th, 2024 meeting at the request of the applicant. Item number seven for Inspirata Town Center Parcel 12. As noted on the agenda, this item has been withdrawn by the applicant. Item number 10, waiver of development standards for the Smith RV Garage has been withdrawn by the applicant. Item number 11, a conditional use permit for Strong Tower New Sanctuary. This is continued to the July 11th, 2024 Planning Commission meeting at the request of the applicant to allow time to submit a conditional use permit for a school. Item number 13, a vacation abandonment for Pabco Warm Springs to Barrett. This is withdrawn at the request of Public Works due to outstanding concerns. And item number 15, a vacation abandonment for Pabco Road, is withdrawn as well at the request of Public Works due to outstanding concerns.
Thank you. Based on the recommendation of staff and in accordance with Planning Commission policy, it is the intention of the Planning Commission to make a motion to continue items as noted. For those of you who were unable to attend the meeting for which the item has been continued, please submit your written comments to the Community Development and Services Department. Is there a motion to accept the agenda?
So moved.
There's a motion on the floor. Please vote. That item passes. This brings us to the consent agenda consisting of items 1 through 6. Item 6 has been continued to the July meeting, and items 3, 4, and 5 are being pulled from the consent agenda. Is there anyone here who wishes to have an item pulled from the consent for discussion or public comment? Seeing no one, may we have a motion on consent agenda items 1 and 2?
So moved.
There's a motion on the floor. Please vote. And that consent agenda passes. Staff, will you please introduce items 3, 4, and 5 and 18? Commissioner Rice, when you get a chance, you'll have to read your disclosure.
Yes. For item number 3 is a tentative map request for a 75-lot residential subdivision within
Development Area 1 within the Lake Moore Plan community. Staff recommends approval of this request. And we're going to read one item in at a time, Commissioner.
Okay. Go ahead and...
My law firm represents Lake Moore Development LLC and Lake Moore Ventures LLC, which have interests in this property, and I perform substantial legal work on the Lake Moore project. Therefore, my judgment in this matter would be materially affected by my commitment and my private capacity to the interests of these clients and to my law firm. Consequently, I have been advised by counsel that I should make this disclosure pursuant to the Nevada ethics laws and that I should abstain from items 3, 4, 5, and 18, all of which pertain to the Lake Moore project.
Staff, are we going to continue with reading item 4, 5, and then we'll get 18
sure.
on its own?
Yep, so item number 4 is a tentative map request for a 144-lot residential subdivision within Development Area 1 within the Lake Moore Plan community. Staff recommends approval of this request. Item number 5 is a tentative map request for a 104-lot single-family residential subdivision within Development Area 1 within the Lake Moore Plan community. Staff recommends approval of this request. And item number 18, vacation. Is a request to vacate a portion of BLM grants for public road and right-of-way easements and public utility easements generally located southwest of the intersection of Lake Mead Parkway and Lake Las Vegas Parkway. Staff recommends approval of that.
Thank you. And commissioners, please note we'll be voting on these individually. Do we have an applicant? Please state your name and zip code for the record.
We concur with all the recommendations of staff.
Thank you. I'll open the public hearing. Is there anyone wishing to speak on item 3? Seeing no one, I'll close the public hearing. Commissioners, comments, questions, or recommendation?
I'm happy if no one else is to make a motion for approval on TMA 20240014618. Subject to conditions.
There's a vote. There's a motion on the floor. Please vote. And that item passes. Do we need to have open a public hearing for each item?
Yes, we do. You can do it all together if you would like.
Okay, so 4 and 5 we can do together?
Yes.
Should we do 18 separately?
Yes.
Okay, so we'll go ahead and do 4 and 5. Is there anyone here? I'll open the public hearing. Is there anyone here wishing to speak on items 4 and 5? Seeing no one, I'll close the public hearing. Commissioners, questions, comments? And we'll go ahead and make this motion for both 4 and 5.
I'll make a motion to approve.
If you could make them separate motions, okay. That would be
and
best.
And vote separately? Okay, thank you. There's a motion on the floor for item number 4, which was final approval of TMA 20240014619, subject to conditions. Please vote. Commissioner
Humes.
Haven't got anything up here yet, no. Do I need to make a...
Take your time. There's no rush. Golf, hockey.
We still have no voting option up here. Should I make a roll call vote? Okay. We'll just make an opportunity for a voice vote. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That item passes. And then moving on to item number 5. Comments, questions, or a motion on item number five? Commissioner Beeson, would you like to make a motion on item number five?
Yes, I'd like to make a motion to approve TMA 202-401-4620.
There's a motion on the floor. Please vote. That item passes. And moving on down to item number 18, does the applicant wish to speak on this item? Would you like to speak on this item? It's kind of separate from the other three.
Yeah, this is just it's a related vacation. So we're good with the staff conditions. You can answer any questions if you have.
Great, thank you. Is there anyone, I'll open the public hearing. Is there anyone wishing to speak on this item? Seeing no one, I'll close the public hearing. Commissioners, comments, questions, or a recommendation, motion?
I'll make the motion to approve BAC 202-401-4603.
There's a motion, please vote. And that item passes.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.
Staff, next item, please.
Item number eight is the next item. It's a four-part request. The first is a request to amend the land use category from medium-density residential to low-density residential. The second is a request to remove a portion of the subject site from the Rainbow Canyon Master Plan and remove the gaming enterprise and master plan overlays. The third is a request to amend a zone change master plan to add the entire site to the Lake Las Vegas North Shore Master Plan, establish low-density residential over the entire site, and request three additional waivers. And the fourth is a tentative map request for a 53-lot residential subdivision. Staff recommends approval.
Thank you. And Commissioner Lewis, you have a disclosure?
I do. Thank you. my employer, Lewis Management, is in the process of selling and has sold land to TriPoint, the applicant on this item. The sold property is located in California, not in any way related to this item, and I'm not involved in the sale of that property. I don't believe the sale materially affects my judgment in considering this matter, and I don't believe that it would affect the judgment of a reasonable person in my situation. I have been advised by counsel to make this disclosure pursuant to Nevada ethics laws, but I do not need to abstain from voting on this item.
Thank you. Applicant name and zip code for the record, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Commissioners, Tom Amick, 1980 Festival Plaza. I'm here on behalf of the applicant, who is TriPoint, in this matter. This is for Lake Las Vegas North Shore Parcel J2A, which is this piece right here. It is the last remaining vacant parcel to be developed in the Rainbow Canyon North Shore area. So this is kind of the piece that's up on the hill a little bit, if you're familiar with that area. This currently has medium density residential land use, and we are taking it down to low density residential land use. There are currently 152 lots that are permitted to be developed on this site. The combination of these parcels here, we are only doing 53. So I wanted to make that clear for the record. We have 9,200 square foot maximum lot sizes, 6,600 minimum. The average is like 7,700, which is very commensurate with what's out there in that area of Lake Las Vegas and Rainbow Canyon. I just wanted to show this to you. Here are the pieces in yellow are the pieces that are still part of the North Shore Master Plan. Everything else in green is Rainbow Canyon. That's why you're seeing kind of the multiple applications and the waivers, because there's this interplay between the two. But all of these waivers have been approved out here in this area multiple times previously. So just to point that out, everything in green and yellow is permitted for 3,500 total units in Rainbow Canyon and North Shore. Even with the addition of these 52, we're only at 3,100. 3,114. So we're well below what was previously approved out there. We did do a neighborhood meeting, and I think hopefully we addressed all of the concerns and questions both at that meeting and then subsequent. In Westwood, had some conversations with a few of the neighbors, to make mostly drainage related. So that's all I have. Can answer any questions for me if you have them.
Thank you. With that, I'll open the public hearing. Is there anyone here that wishes to speak on this item? If you go ahead and come down, just as a reminder for some of you that have arrived a little bit late, if you want to speak on an item, when the agenda item comes up, after I've opened the public hearing, if you would please line up in the center aisle so we have an idea of how many people want to speak on the agenda item. And also, you'll have 3 minutes to speak. You'll see a green light. That green light will start with 3 minutes. It'll go to yellow at 2 minutes and 30 seconds. And then at red, we'll ask you to wrap it up at the yellow light.
Okay. Hi, Bill.
Thanks. Yeah. So state your name and zip code for the record.
Thomas Sarno, and I live in Reverie Heights. My house will look directly onto this. I have a map. So my house is...
Get that right on that Henderson logo there.
Oh, okay.
And then we can see it up here. If you want to point to anything on there.
Just that this is where I live. This is my house. So they're going to build right across. Currently, the two questions I had, currently there's like a berm or, you know, buildup of rock and stuff, dirt. I was wondering if that's staying because that would affect my view. And second of all, I heard they might dynamite and take that all down, and I was wondering if that was true too.
Okay.
Those were my concerns. Thank you.
I'll get those answered for you. Thanks.
Okay. Do you need me to leave this? Or?
No. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, guys.
Hello, name and zip code.
Good afternoon. Kim Huber, 89011 Del Webb, Lake Las Vegas. We're wondering where the access to this development is. Highland Shores is currently 20 miles per hour because of limited site distance. Adding an access point on there would contribute to disruptive traffic and dangerous situations. We'd like to know where that is.
Okay, thank you. Come on down. And your name and zip code for the record, please.
Gina Abdallah DeMarcus, zip code 89011. I live in the same neighborhood right across the street. Let me put the little map down here. Okay. The other gym.
You can use the mic that's to your right in front of you.
Oh, this one. Okay.
Yeah, you can slide that forward if you want.
Okay. Am I blocking the map?
Yep.
Okay. From this project, the other neighbor is here, and this is what he's concerned about right here in this area. We're here. My concern, I had spoke with somebody with this in this development and kind of gave me an idea of what they were going to be doing, but this was a little bit what concerned me, because we back up looking at the lake right here in this area, and we come around the corner here to get out of Reverie Development. Here I was told that this was supposed to end up being some type of utility street, that they're going to open up all the way down to Lake Las Vegas Boulevard there. So I was concerned about that. Also, this area in here, because they told me right above, right along the line of the homes here, across the street from their home, is open. There's a mountain that starts from here and it carries all the way up. And by the time you get in this area, which is the first street in the development, it's the hill extremely high. And they told me that these homes were gonna fall down below the neighborhood, that these homes will be looking over and down into this new development, not looking upward into their backyards. Now, as he told me, they were going to come downhill, but I wanted to know, he said he's going to put a view fence, because we got a lot of view fences out there along the curve here. I wanted to know, what is this area here going to be used for? All this. I see the cul-de-sacs in here, and I'm assuming all these homes are going to have walls or some type of backyards and sidewalls and what have you. but we just got this information today, and we just need a little bit more answers. And like the first gentleman said, we were really interested to know whether or not they're going to be doing any dynamite, because between here, the other homes that's over here, and us on this side, it's a really tight area to put the 53 homes in. So I'm not saying I'm against it, it's just I want to know what they're going to do and how it's going to fit in here, because dynamite will blow all of us up. That's how close it is.
Right.
So we just really want to know what's happening.
Great, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, name and zip code for the record, please.
89011. Name's Tom DeMarcus. I also live in Reverie. And
we can see it.
Okay, you can see it. Okay. Well, actually, she's my wife, so we live in the same house. My question was, well, one was, when are they going to start this project, and when's it going to finish? Because there's going to be a lot of noise, there's going to be a lot of dust. So we want to get a start and finish date for this project. Now this hill, this berm is way higher. It's a very beautiful view from our home. But supposedly these houses are going to be built, they're going to dig this berm out, and the houses are going to be lower than our homes. But right now, the hill is way above our homes. So how are they going to do that? I think that's why she was asking about the dynamite. Because you'd be there forever digging that out. I mean, if you're just using scrapers, it'll be there for, I don't know. That's what I'm asking.
Okay.
Okay.
I'll try to get an answer for you.
That's my question.
Right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Did you have?
I guess you don't need this no more.
Did you want to speak, sir?
I do.
Okay. Come on up to the podium. I'll need your name and zip code for the record.
My name is John Guess, 89011. And I live in the Vantage subdivision, which is right next to the build site here. My question is regarding the maintenance road, they call it, the access road. Are they going to put a fence along there, or is it going to be a high traffic area? I mean, they're putting a lot of homes with gullies and this crazy stuff. But anyway, that maintenance road is right next to our home, and I'm very interested in, is it going to be a high use access for the development? Is it an emergency access for like a fire gate or something like that? So that's my question.
Okay. Thank you. We'll try to get that answer for you. Anybody else here wishing to speak on this item? Seeing no one, I'll close the public hearing. If the applicant could address some of those questions, I think starting with a berm.
I think I can get all of these here for you guys. Okay, so let's do the easy ones first. First off, no blasting with this project, which we stated at the neighborhood meeting as well. So we take that off the table. Second, with regard to the maintenance road, so that is not a full access for the residents. That is not, no residents will be on that road. It is not even an emergency access. That is a maintenance road for the city, because there are utilities under that. It's not even a right of way. It's literally a maintenance road for the city that we must maintain out to Lake Las Vegas Parkway. But it is completely gated and barricaded at Lake Las Vegas Parkway. So the only people that can get on that road are the city when they need to access the maintenance road. So nobody, that is not an access of any kind for the development. The access is over here. It is, call it 150, 200 feet before the Del Webb access on the right. So we are taking our access right here. It's off the map a little bit, but theirs is would be a little bit further up. So it's not even directly across. So as far as the traffic goes, we are so much less dense than what was approved here. So in terms of the traffic and the traffic study that was done for the Rainbow Canyon and North Shore area, we would be well underneath those projections in terms of average daily trips for the cars. With regard to the area that they're referring to here, so first off, there is a view fence along the property line. The areas that are not encumbered by the lots, that is all native desert land, basically. Anything that we disturb out there that we are not building homes on will be revegetated, as is required by your code and by the Rainbow Canyon and North Shore standards. So nothing in between, in these open space areas, that is just native land. As far as the heights, they're right. There's a little bit of a hill here in this area that we are taking down a little bit, but we'll still be a little bit higher here than them, between 20, 25 feet, probably a little bit higher in these areas, but we're like 60 to 80 feet away also from that property line. Up here, it's much closer. So these lots up here are going to be on the same plane, if you will, more or less, as the lots that are across from them. So, and then, you know, if you picture a hill up here, then it falls away as you go off the backside. So these would be lower or going down the hill as you go this way. So I think I got everything. Did I miss anything?
Question on the open space.
Yes.
And the utility, I'm going to call it a utility easement.
Yes.
So the question was, is there anything going in there?
No. So it is completely enclosed. It is not accessible by any residents to drive on. So it's this little road that goes down here. It's I don't think that's even paved. I think that's a like a decomposed granite pathway. It's not meant for travel by any of the residents. It is a maintenance road for the city because of the utilities that lie underneath.
Great, thank you. And then the starting, is there an estimated starting date?
Oh. Yeah, I was going to say, but, you know, we still have to do civil improvement plans. You got some grading here given the existing topography of the hill, but it's 8 to 12 months before we're out there doing anything.
Commissioners, any questions, comments, or a motion?
I just want to ask the gentleman that came up here, did that answer your question? Good. Okay.
Thank you.
I'm sorry, I've closed the...
No blasting.
Yeah,
she asked if there was any blasting or dynamite.
I've closed the public hearing, so please, when we close the public hearing, understand, you know, there are no more comments coming from the audience. I wish we could, but that when it's closed, it's closed. So thank you, though. So is there a motion?
I'll make a motion for approval of CPA 2024-014427, subject to findings of fact, conditions, and waivers.
All of them.
Oh, CZA 2011-500286-A18, CZO-2002-6700-53-A7, and TMA 2024-014428. Subject to findings of fact, conditions, and waiver.
There's a motion. Please vote. And that item passes.
Thank you.
All right, the next item is item number 9. This is a request to amend a conditional use permit to review live entertainment operations and modify condition number 6 to extend the hours of operation for the outdoor live entertainment from 10 p.m. to midnight at an existing tavern located at 445 Mark Street. Staff recommends denial of the extended hours of operation, and Mr. Adams will be making a brief presentation explaining staff's denial.
You have a solution?
I do.
Okay. Commissioner...
I do. As to item 9, my law firm represents Parkway Management and its principals, an affiliated entity of Parkway Marks LLC, the applicant on this item. Given my law firm's ongoing representation of this client, the independence of judgment of a reasonable person could be materially affected by my commitment and my private capacity to the interests of my law firm and to this client. Consequently, I have been advised by counsel that I should make this disclosure pursuant to Nevada ethics laws and that I should abstain from matters in which Parkway Marks is an owner or applicant. Thank you.
Thank you. Staff, you have a presentation for us?
I do. Brian Adams, 240 Water Street. As Mr. Taskel mentioned, the applicant is requesting to extend the hours of operation for their existing use permit
for outdoor live entertainment from 10 p.m. to midnight. Staff is recommending denial of this request based on two primary factors, the first of which is since this application was originally approved back in October of 2023, there's been a lack of events held outdoors to kind of establish some, to establish that they can operate responsibly without getting a noise complaint to the 10 o'clock deadline. But the second and probably more important point is that there are four approved hotels in the area, three of which are built. So these three, this hotel is approved, not yet built. And there's also a residential neighborhood, all of which are within 600 feet of this this tavern. So because of that, we felt like the 10 o'clock deadline is enough because of the residential hotels that are there and then also the residential neighborhood. And if this application were to be denied, they would still maintain their 10 o'clock outdoor approval and no limitation to the live entertainment on the indoor portion. With that.
Thank you. We have an applicant on this item. Please state your name and zip code for the record.
Jonathan Fine, 89119. there are hundreds of taverns in the valley between Henderson and Las Vegas. the majority of them are 21 and over, smoking, dark, and they're meant for gambling. We have been successful because we have bright, wide open, family-friendly locations. We've been successful because of that. Whether it is bringing community events to the area, live music on certain nights, karaoke, we've been successful because we bring everybody together. It's a different class of bar, tavern, restaurant to the valley. We've been extremely successful with it, and that's our business model. Aside from creating a successful model, we employ about 50 people in the place. We have a few locations where the live music didn't work, and so in the neighborhood, we just got rid of all of the other stuff that we had, and we chose the model of the 21 and over smoking gambling hall, which you would see in a PT's or a Dottie's, and they're successful. And all we're asking is for two more hours. We don't have heavy metal bands. We don't have crazy things. We typically have a person with a guitar sitting outside singing into a microphone. We had an unfortunate event that led to this, which was a band that performed for a party that was on the patio. They didn't feel like they had enough people, so they turned the speakers out. They upset a neighbor that was a mile away, so I can't even imagine, I wasn't there, how loud they were blasting the music. But we are simply requesting 2 hours. It's hard if people are gonna come in for dinner and they eat dinner at 8 o'clock, they walk outside, they sit, you know, for an hour, you know, having a glass of wine or a cocktail, and to tell them that there's no more music, you have to go inside if it's a beautiful night. We're talking about a very small fraction of nights that happen throughout the year that we would be using our patio, and all we're doing is requesting two more hours. And the hotel that's nearby, we've never had a complaint from them, and actually we get a lot of our business from them, so I don't want to upset anybody. But all we're asking is to allow, you know, a handful of nights a year that we have a singer, and so we're not breaking any rules by having someone sit outside. We even offered to get a decibel reader and make sure that it's below a whisper if you're within 50 feet. So if you're standing on the sidewalk in front of our venue, it's a whisper at loudest, which would be 50 decibels on the, so that's where we are, and we appreciate the time and everyone putting in. It's a lot of effort for 2 hours of business. So thank you guys all for the consideration.
Thank you. Once I close the public hearing. At this time, I'll go ahead and open the public hearing. I want to remind anybody that's speaking that if you agree with a person that has previously spoken, in other words, you're you've heard, we've heard what they've already said. Please just state, I agree, we have the same concern. You don't need to go into too much detail about it. We get it, and that will move us along a little bit quicker. So as a reminder, if you'd please state your name and your zip code for the record.
Edward Hannigan, 89052. I represent the owners of the Comfort Inn, which is across the street, and also the Sleep Inn, which is in the process of being constructed. I agree with staff's recommendations that the application should be denied. And just very briefly, the Henderson has a noise ordinance. Music is per se in violation of it. Loudspeakers are per se in violation. It's just not conducive to the area. There's four motels right in the area. People don't necessarily go to bed at after 10 o'clock. We're not that crazy about the music until 10 o'clock. But certainly between 10 and midnight, I think, is opening the door to problems.
Thank you very much. Name and zip code for the record.
Sorry, I'm short. My name is Miracle, zip code 89014. I'm one of the managers of the hotels directly located near the Parkway Tavern. But prior to my experience at this Hampton Inn, I was at the Marriott cluster behind Allegiant Stadium. We happen to be about a half a mile away from Larry Flynt's Hustler Club. And the noise that came from their indoor music gave me guest complaints on a nightly basis. Every weekend, I was losing money due to having to refund guests for their unhappy stays. I lost a ton of guest scores and recommendations. I went from a 70% guest satisfaction to a 30% guest satisfaction due to the fact that noise does travel. And we were in a situation where there was a large construction site next to us for crane parking, truck parking, all of that. And that noise still traveled a half a mile into multiple hotels as well. So if indoor music a half a mile away is a problem for multiple hotels, how do we think that outdoor music 500 feet away is going to affect us? We are a little bit concerned about that. So thank you for your consideration.
Thank you. Name and zip code for the record.
Hi, Jody Sander, 89014. I'm representing the Holiday Inn Express in the Hampton Inn, but I wanted to give you just a couple specific complaints that I've received. One says, depending on where your room is facing, you may hear noise or music from the station casino at night. The casino next door had bad music blaring, and it took a while to figure out where it was coming from. And not a property issue, but in the parking lot, there's people outside honking horns and music playing until 3 in the morning. So those are some of the complaints that we already are receiving, and nothing's been extended. So please follow staff's recommendation. We would really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you. And name and zip code, please.
Rich Tobler of Richard L. Tobler Limited, 89149. I represent Henderson Hospitality, which is the owner of two hotels in close proximity, that being Hampton Inn and also the Holiday Inn Express. And I've made a prior objection in writing along with other constituents of mine associated with this application in opposition. And this, again, we'll put that up there to show the proximity of these hotels, four of which will have on any given busy night 800 guests within very close earshot of this patio. That is amplified music. It wants to continue to 12 o'clock midnight. We're in the business of marketing sleep and rest. This is not conducive to that purpose. This is a hotel corridor. It's a quiet corridor. It's not an entertainment district. And that's the way we want to keep it, because the problem nowadays is social, the social networking that goes out there stays on record. A bad report will stay on record for years. That plagues us and hampers us with our ability to acquire guests and benefit the city of Henderson and my clients as well. And so this is completely out of line. I know that there's a housing development to the south here that, according to staff's recommendations, also has made objection to this purpose. But it just doesn't belong. It's not. There's no other use like it around it. And you know, there's we did not receive notice of the original application back in October. That in no way means that we ratify or consent to that. We just didn't receive notice to object to it. So with that in mind, this purpose is not appropriate for this region. And this commission has to balance the harms. It's the incremental business of 2 hours versus the rest and satisfaction of 800 guests immediately adjacent to it. So on that basis, we would request that we follow staff's recommendation to deny this request because it is not conducive to the area. Thank you.
Thank you. Name and zip code for the record, please.
Hello, my name is Kent Clausen, 99212. I am one of the owners of the two referenced hotels, and I wanted to introduce some other facts that have not yet been talked about. You'd heard about sound, the devastating impact in sound. We've been running hotels for 30 years in 6 different states, and we just know it all too well. And just today, in addition to the objection to Holiday Inn franchisor submitted previously in your packet, just today I got a letter from Holiday Inn stating that they would not even approve a hotel at that location given the nature of the music that's being proposed. Okay, so I think that's relevant. This is simple land use 101, it seems to me. They're incompatible uses. We have had a wonderful relationship with the Parkway Tavern. We send them lots of business and they cater for us and it's been wonderful. But this changes the game. This, as Rich mentioned, we sell sleep. They sell food and liquor. I would not even imagine coming in front of you and asking for me to get a special favor, if you will, but that would hinder their ability to sell food and liquor. But that's what's happening to us. We're going to have we're being hindered in our ability to sell sleep. And on social media today, as has been mentioned, it's just devastating. So this is a lose-lose-lose, in my opinion. We're going to lose. The tavern's going to lose because there'll be less people going there from the hotels, all 4 of them, not just our 2. And the city's going to lose. We spent $14 million, we've remitted $14 million of tax to the city, including almost $1 million of room tax, to promote the city, to turn around and make them angry, just as silly, and they're not compatible uses from a land use perspective, a planning perspective. It's completely inappropriate. Thank you.
Thank you. Name and zip code for the record, please.
Monica, 89014, general manager of the Comfort Inn and Suites. I agree with everything that was said. I also have some reviews that were based off of the Sunset Station concerts that are right next to our hotel. And when we build Sleep Inn, that's going to be right next to Parkway. 2 hours really will make the difference. When Sunset has their concerts till 10, we still get a ton of complaints. I'm losing revenue. I have to give adjustments, and guest satisfaction definitely does show on our review status. Some of the reviews that we've gotten is Sunset Station Casino was so loud that the bass actually vibrated my bed. It was so, the outdoor concert was so loud that we couldn't even hear our own TV. And basically that they will never be back because of the live concert next door. So I basically agree.
Thank you. Hello, name and zip code for the record, please.
My name is James McKellar, and I'm the owner of the Comfort Inn, which I've owned for 15 years. I developed that project 15 years ago, and I'm also currently developing a 95-unit hotel called the Sleep Inn, which is right across the street from the tavern. And I never thought I'd be up here having to defend, I understand that this would be in a violation of several codes you have on the books. There is a curfew up till 10 o'clock, and this, I never thought I'd have to be fighting against a potential would-be violation of that code. I think it's a duty and obligation for the city to uphold the existing codes. And therefore, I am vehemently against this application. Thank you.
Can I have your zip code, please?
I'm sorry?
Zip code? Your zip code, for the record. What, you mentioned your name, but not your zip code.
475 Mark Street is the address of the Comfort Inn, and the one under construction is 445 Mark Street.
Okay, thank you very much. Appreciate your comments.
Thank you.
Is there anybody else wishing to speak on this item? Seeing no one, I'll close the public hearing. Commissioners, questions, comments?
I have a couple of questions, mainly for the owners. How long have you had that business?
I think we've been in that location 8 years.
8 years? Are you guys doing okay? Business?
We've pulled all of the entertainment that was anywhere outside during the times, and we went from doing about $65,000 a week to just under $20,000 a week. So we did take a dramatic hit. And that, by the way, that's an extreme number because we did pull everything as to not upset everyone. And for the record, we had a band three different times, consecutive weeks, I think 3 years ago or 4 years ago. That was an unfortunate incident when they turned the speakers around to try and play to the parking lot. We're not looking for that. We were just looking for someone standing outside or sitting on a chair playing a guitar. And I have some videos if anyone wanted to see that. But, you know, again, we appreciate everything we get from the hotels and all of our neighbors. We never want to upset anyone. We just also don't want to break any rules. And that's why we applied for this.
Are you surprised that any of your employees are not here tonight to back you up?
I didn't tell my employees that I was coming here.
Oh, okay. All right. Thank you.
Any other questions?
That's it for me.
Is there a motion?
Well, I still have a couple of questions.
Oh, I'm sorry,
for one of the residents that came forward. How long have you guys lived in that subdivision that you're in?
Commissioner, I've closed the public hearing, so you need to address.
Well, I can't ask them a question.
You need to ask the questions only of the applicant.
Okay, you could raise your fingers if you want to answer.
Commissioner, we're not going to do that. Thank you very much. I appreciate your effort and desire.
Well, but nobody came forward. And what a lot of people don't understand about something like this is setting precedent. When something like this is approved, then what do we do if somebody else wants to open one a quarter of a mile from you? So it's tough. It's tough. But it's not fair to the people that live there either. And the way the map is looking, and since I can't ask, they're pretty close. I think they're within a half a mile, most of them.
Closer.
Oh, and closer than a half a mile. Okay. Do you think they get much sleep?
We haven't had, in 8 years, we've had two complaints, and it was the same band that was performing, the same incident. We pulled everything as to not upset everybody.
But a lot of the people come from the hotels. That means they're out of town. That's probably why you haven't gotten a lot of complaints, would you think?
We haven't had any entertainment outside. There's been zero.
Well, it would just be very tough to set precedent. Thank you.
Would you like to make a motion, Commissioner?
What?
Would you like to make a motion?
Oh, sure, absolutely. Yes, I would like to stick with the City of Henderson, make a motion for denial on CUP 20-13243-A1.
There's a motion on the floor. Please vote. And that motion for denial passes. Thank you. Next item, please.
Thank you for your time.
So item number 10 was withdrawn. Item 11 was continued. So that brings us to item number 12, which is a conditional use permit request for a stealth wireless communication facility and includes a modification to increase the maximum height from 45 feet to 80 feet located at Mission Hills Park. Staff recommends approval, and park planning staff will be also making a brief presentation.
Okay. Hello.
Good afternoon. Oh, can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Good afternoon. Amy Wojcik, 240 Water Street. And you guys can see it. You guys will be able to see it, yes. So from a follow-up from last month's meeting, we wanted to come back and bring a little bit more information to you for Mission Hills Park, the cell tower. So a little bit of the history of it is back in January of 2023, AT&T had a meeting with multiple departments of the city where they discussed having desire to put some cell towers in parks. The benefit of having the cell towers that are co-locatable is one, they're co-locatable. They can have multiple carriers and there's increased coverage, and then also it helps for emergency services. They did, as I said, they had interest in some park sites. That was four of them, including Mission Hills. And design options were presented to us, and ultimately, after review and so forth, we did select the mono-stealth pole to be more appropriate for this project site. The tower design was presented to our planning and executive design, development executive steering committee back in March of last year. And then the applicant, AT&T, did hold a community meeting, neighborhood meeting, where, and that was held in April, and they had only one resident attend the meeting. And then we make sure that when they do have cell towers that come in, we do have them do their neighborhood meetings before they come to park board. So they did come in June of last year to present, and that was approved. Some additional information, out of our 73 parks, we only have 8 towers in our parks right now. So there's 8 parks with towers. And of those towers, 33, or over a third of them, have the mono-stealth poles. For Mission Hills, it was a lot of consideration on that one because we have the existing flagpole tower and we know it's a landmark item and people use it to identify where the park is and so forth. So there was a lot of thought and consideration put into that. And ultimately where the selection was made is to the south end of the park where it is in the maintenance area, or will be in the maintenance area. So it's not taking up any park space. And in addition to that, we felt there was value in having it put in the maintenance area. So the AT&T will be constructing a wall to enclose the maintenance area. Currently, it's just an existing chain link fence. And the wall will provide better security. And with that, they're also going to be providing power. So again, added security for the site. And with the wall, we saw it as an opportunity to maybe in the future have a mural put up on it so we can comply with our Healthy, Livable, Sustainable City Strategic Plan Initiative. So in addition, we took it to keep it down at the ground level versus it having it up high for the value of the park. I think that is it.
Great, thanks.
I can show you, want to see more pictures? Here's the existing condition on the west, or on the left side of the image, or the left side of the sheet, and then the right-hand side is the proposed. And that view is from San Gabriel. And then the next one is, again, the existing is on Arrowhead, or existing is on the left side, and the view is from Arrowhead Trail. And then the last one is from Scholar Street.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you. Is the applicant here? Screen.
Good afternoon, Commissioners. My name is Ken Lyons here on behalf of AT&T as well as Public Safety Towers, Inc. And zip code would be 89119 for AT&T's office. All that to say, we appreciate the opportunity to collaborate with the City of Henderson as well as the Parks Department on designs to improve coverage, certainly within these communities. And we agree with all the recommendations that the staff has made regarding this this project, and happy to answer any questions you might have. Thank you.
Thank you very much. With that, I'll open the public hearing. Is there anyone here wishing to speak on this item? Seeing no one, I'll close the public hearing. It appears that Commissioner Lewis's computer has caught her virus or whatever she has tonight. It's all red. If someone could come see about that, that would be great. But With that, I'll open it up for the commissioners' questions, comments, or a motion.
Barring any questions, I would move for approval of CUP 2024-014418.
There's a motion on the floor. Please vote. Commissioner Lewis?
An aye.
An aye? Okay. Yes. And that item passes. Thank you very much. Next item, please.
Next item is number 14, which is a request to vacate a portion of a right-of-way located approximately 400 feet southeast of the King Street and Papco Road intersection. Staff recommends approval.
We have a name and zip code for the record, please.
Yes, Lorenzo.
Oh, I'm sorry. Bear with me just a second.
Sorry. My last one. My law firm represents the Landwell Company, the applicant on this item, and we have or may perform work that is directly related to the property at issue in these applications. Given the scope of my law firm's representation of this client, the independence of judgment of a reasonable person could be materially affected by my commitment in my private capacity to the interests of my law firm and to this client. Consequently, I've been advised by counsel that I should make this disclosure pursuant to Nevada ethics laws and that I should abstain from matters involving the Landwell Company.
Thank you, Commissioner. Applicant name and zip code for the record, please.
Lorenzo Sanchez with Wood Rogers, 8345 West Sunset Road, representing the applicant Landwell Company. We have read and agree with all the conditions and ask for your approval.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'll open the public hearing. Is there anyone wishing to speak on this item? Seeing no one, I'll close the public hearing. Commissioners, question, comments, or a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve. I'm sorry, I said looking at three of them. VAC 202-401-4490.
There's a motion on the floor. Please vote.
I'm an aye.
Aye. Commissioner Lewis is voting aye. We don't have anything up on our screen yet. Take a vote. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Aye.
That motion carries. Next item, please.
Next item is number 16, which is a request to vacate a non-exclusive utility use easement generally located southeast of the intersection of Taylor Street and Water Street. Staff recommends approval.
Get down here. Name and zip code for the record, please.
Larry Bitten, 89014. And we concur with staff's one condition and appreciate your approval.
Great, thank you very much. Is there anyone?
Did you forget my disclosure?
Oh, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Do I not count? Are you forgetting me?
Yes.
Yeah, I want to go ahead and make a disclosure. My employer, Lewis Management Corp, is in the process of selling land to Lenora and affiliate of Greystone, the property owner on this item, and the Woodside, the developer on this item. The sold properties are in California, not in any way related to this application. I'm not involved with the sale of the property. I don't believe the sale would materially affect my judgment in considering this matter, and I don't believe that this would affect the judgment of a reasonable person in my situation. I have been advised to make the disclosure, but that I do not need to abstain from voting on this item.
Thank you, Commissioner. I'll go ahead and open the public hearing. Is there anyone wishing to speak on this item? Seeing no one, I'll close the public hearing. Commissioners?
I will make a motion for approval of VAC 2024-014490, subject to a finding of fact and a condition.
There's a motion. Please vote.
An aye.
Commissioner Lewis voted aye, and that item passes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Item 17 is a request to vacate a portion of a right-of-way generally located east of the intersection of Perigee Bay Drive and Lake Las Vegas Parkway. Staff recommends approval.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman. Commissioners, John Marciano, 218 Led Street. We concur with the recommendation of staff.
Thank you very much. I'll open the public hearing. Is there anyone wishing to speak on this item? Seeing no one, I close the public hearing. Commissioners, questions, comments, or a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve VAC 2024-014454, subject to a finding of fact and a condition.
There is a motion on the floor. Please vote.
I'll vote. Oh.
Commissioner Lewis?
I'll vote aye.
That item passes.
Next item is item 19, which is a request to vacate portions of a public rights-of-way and utility easement generally located 1 mile southwest of the intersection of Old US 95 and Silver Line Road. Staff recommends approval.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman. Commissioners John Marciano, 218 Lead Street, along with Mr. Amick, representing the applicant. We concur with the recommendations of staff.
Thank you. I'll open the public hearing. Is there anyone wishing to speak on this item? Seeing no one, I'll close the public hearing. Commissioners?
I'll make a motion to approve VAC 20240-14002, subject to finding of fact and condition.
There's a motion. Please vote. Vote aye. Commissioner Lewis?
I'll vote aye.
That item passes. Thank you very much.
So item 20 is a master sign plan amendment with modification to increase the maximum square footage of a monument sign from 50 square feet to 277 square feet and increase the allowed height of a monument sign from 6 feet to 8 feet, 8 inches, located in the Black Mountain Plan community. Staff recommends approval of this request.
Applicant name and zip code for the record, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Commissioners Tom Amick, 1980 Festival Plaza.
Have a couple disclosures on this one.
I'm sorry, what?
We have a couple disclosures.
Oh,
disclosures.
I was trying to do too many things.
We've got too much stuff happening.
All right, I think we got this guy working. Thanks to our awesome tech support. On this one also, my employer, Lewis Management, is in the process and has sold land to Lenore, the affiliate of Greystone, on this item. The sold property is located in California, not related to this application. And I'm not involved with the sale of the property. I don't believe the sale would materially affect my judgment in the considering this matter. I don't believe that it would affect the judgment of a reasonable person. In this situation, I have been advised to make this disclosure pursuant to Nevada ethics laws, but I do not need to abstain.
Thank you, Commissioner.
One more. I'd like to disclose that I reside in the Ridgeview portion of the Black Mountain Ranch community, which is the master plan community where this applicant's sign is proposed to be installed. The sign is proposed for a different part of Black Mountain Ranch than the subdivision where I live. And I do not think the independence of judgment of a reasonable person in my situation would be materially affected by residing in the same master plan community. Therefore, I've been advised by counsel to make this disclosure, but that I do not have to abstain from deliberation and voting on this item.
Thank you, Commissioner. And the applicant may continue.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Sorry, Tom Amick, 1980 Festival Plaza. With me is Mr. Marciano. We are here on behalf of Lenar, who, as you all know, is the developer of the Black Mountain Ranch Master Plan. So what we have before you tonight is the entry monument signage for the Founders Village off of Greenway. So you guys have seen a few of these residential signage applications before. You have to count basically everything you see in my picture in the square footage, even though the actual signage itself, the lettering, is 81 square feet, but I think staff concurs with us that what we're proposing is cooler and looks a lot better and matches more or less with what else, with the other monument signage that you see out there in Black Mountain Ranch. So we appreciate the recommendation for approval. We can answer any questions if you have them.
Thank you very much. I'll open the public hearing. Is there anyone wishing to speak on this item? Seeing no one, I'll close the public hearing. Commissioners, questions, comments?
Just a comment. There is a sign almost identical to that in that subdivision, just so you know. I mean, it's great. Looks good.
Thank you. Yep.
Would you like to make a motion?
Sure. I'll make a motion to approve MSP 2021-0081-81-A1.
Subject to conditions.
Subject to
thank you.
Conditions there's, and approval.
There's a motion on the floor. Please vote. That item passes. Good luck with
thank
that.
Thank you very much.
Item number 21 is a five-part application. The first part is a conditional use permit request for a gas station. The second item is a conditional use permit request for a restaurant with drive-through facility. And the third is a waiver request to reduce the minimum required setback from 10 feet to 5 feet. The fourth is a tentative map request for a one-lot commercial subdivision. And the fifth request is a design review for building and site design for a new commercial center. Staff recommends denial of item A for the gas station and recommends approval of all other items as noted. Mr. Adams will be providing a brief presentation on this item. And staff notes for the Planning Commission that there's going to be two motions. They need to hear item A first and then the rest of the items together. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Brian Adams, 240 Water Street. The applicant's requesting to build six buildings located on a four and approximately three-quarter acre site located in the median of the Via Inspirata. This is the second development. The first median on the northern portion has already been built. This is now the southern piece. The site is located within the Inspirata Town Center Master Plan, and staff is recommending approval of all items with the exception of the use permit for the gas station, which essentially is the canopy portion that I'm identifying here. So the concerns with that are really three-part. The first is that the conditional, first is, and most importantly, it would be that the conditional use permit criteria requires the applicant and staff to identify a need for the proposed use, and that's for any conditional use permit being proposed. So, and I don't know if we can zoom in to just this map area here, but this is the site that is being proposed within the median, and along Via Inspirata within the 2 mile area on the same street, there's five separate gas stations, all with frontage on Via Inspirata. So in that staff's opinion, that did not, this separate application doesn't meet the need request for an additional gas station. The second point is that the design guidelines for the Inspirata Town Center outline a variety of uses planned for the master plan. I'll summarize just the primary uses that were identified, which are banks, restaurants, grocery stores, office complexes, theaters, and repair services. So those are just the primary uses that are specifically identified in the plan. For any of the zoning categories listed here, commercial being one of them, which is the subject zoning. The master plan also, so it doesn't outright prohibit gas station uses. We're not anti-gas station by any means, but it also, we don't want to proliferate a gas station use within a master plan that doesn't identify it as either a primary or secondary use. So there's already one gas station, like I mentioned in the roundabout here. So a second would just continue the trend of building uses that are not listed as primary or secondary uses in the Inspirata master plan, Inspirata Town Center master plan. So the third concern is, I'm going to go back to the original plan here, site plan, is concern over parking of the fuel trucks when they're refueling the in-ground fuel tanks. They'll be pulling in here and parking, and this is one of the only areas in or out of the site. There's also additional areas here, but it clogging this area up that once a car turns to commit, there's nowhere else for them to go. So we're concerned with there being conflicts with the fueling portion of the request. So with that, be happy to answer any questions.
Okay, thank you.
So Brian, the ingress and egress are really compromised, correct? Because of
that's staff's opinion. I did say I'd be happy to answer any questions. I'd like to actually, should have said I'd like to turn it over to the applicant, and then we'll handle some questions after the applicant has a chance to speak. I apologize. That's my fault.
Okay, Brian.
Thank you. Applicant, I'll need your name and zip code for the record, please. And if there are more than one of you presenting, I'll need each of your names and each of your zip codes.
Aaron Yashofar, 90212. I'm the project manager for the applicant proposing this development. We agree with all the recommendations of the staff, except we don't agree with the denial of the gas station. In its report, the staff comes up with basic three reasons for denial of the gas station. One is their concern over the number of the pumps. Then the second, as Brian just mentioned, some concern about fueling truck blocking the fire lane or the ingress or egress or not fitting between the canopy and the fuel tank. And the third, the necessity of the gas station, whether it's a overkill of gas station in the neighborhood or not. I'm going to try to address all the three concerns that the staff has raised and see if we can, then later on, I would be happy to answer any questions that you have. Initially, we proposed an 8-pump gas station, the same as the 7-Eleven north of us has. The staff recommended us to reduce it to 6. We accepted the staff's recommendation of reducing to 6, but now the staff says they're not happy with the 6. Where the gas station just north of us has 8 in a much smaller area with much worse circulation path of travel there. There is a diagram here which shows the path of travel for fueling tanks, fueling trucks. The blue shaded area shows how the fuel trucks will come into the property, where they will park for fueling, and how they would get out. As you will see, the truck easily fits between the fuel tanks and the canopy. The path of travel, these are radiuses which are created and calculated by the civil engineer. The truck can easily maneuver and park behind that island, away from any path of travel, and well, while it's fueling, there is absolutely no obstruction to ingress or the egress of the project. It simply stays there, away from any traffic, not blocking any path of travel, not blocking any fire lane, and easily maneuvers out and drives out of the project without disturbing the rest of the project, without creating any circulation issues. Then the third issue, that the third concern, whether a gas station is needed or not. Obviously, Circle K was proposing to build this gas station, have done their feasibility study. They are committing to spend somewhere between $6 and $8 million to improve and build this gas station. The fact that they are committing to that kind of investment in this location, it's a proof that there is a need. Otherwise, nobody, they're not a nonprofit organization, they're not doing this for hobby. They only build gas station when there is a demand and where they can make money. And they have determined that it does make financial sense, the area needs. Everybody knows the gas station to the north, 7-Eleven, whether it was poor design, whether it was too many pumps in a very small area, has problems, a circulation problem. The exit, the path of exit for the cars and the fuel trucks are not straightforward. They got to travel or either run or turn around, create a traffic or go all the way through the project to exit the development through the north. We spent a lot of time designing something which creates no traffic obstruction for the rest of the project, an easy, straightforward in and out for the fueling trucks as well as the customers that come in and they go out without creating any traffic problem for anyone. One of the arguments that the staff makes is this is just a duplicate of the project to the north. We cannot take the gas station, the Circle K project, stand alone as one project. We are proposing a 6-building development. Initially, before previous owners, before we took over this project, the proposed site plan was a 4-use project, a gas station, a car wash, and 2 drive-throughs. Obviously, the staff was not happy. When we took over the project, we met with the city staff and said, what is it that you like? They said, we don't want car wash. We took it out. We want only one drive-through. We eliminated the second one. And then they said, we like to have medical users for the project because the community needs it. Based on that, we brought three medical users. We brought an emergency room, a dental office, and urgent care. More than 50% of the project is medical use, which the community really needs. So this project, we have to evaluate it as a whole. We can't say we don't want this piece, but the rest is good. The project as a whole benefits the community. And the gas station alone needs benefits the community, because with the casino opening, with all the developments in the immediate area shaping up, the gas station to the north of 7-Eleven already has congestion problem. This gas station would alleviate some of that problem, help the congestion of the project to the north. So not only this is not a detriment, we strongly believe this is a benefit, not to the community, not for our project, but also for the project to the north. Alleviate some of the congestions of the project to the north. And for those reasons, we request respectfully to approve the gas station as well as part of the project, because we're most likely the project will not pencil out without the gas station component. We need this project as a whole to financially make it feasible. We'll be around, and the engineers of the record are here, and a representative of Circle K are also here to answer any questions that you might have.
Great, thank you very much, appreciate that. With that, I'll open the public hearing. Is there anyone here wishing to speak on this item? Come on down and give us your name and zip code for the record, please.
Hi, my name is Andrew Stett, 89044. I wasn't actually planning on talking, but I really appreciate all the work that they're doing. But my concern is also with the gas station, more that it's like a waste of critical space there. That I agree with the staff with the number of gas stations, and also there's a lot of us in the community that have electric vehicles and don't benefit from those. I personally, a lot of the people that I know in the community have electric vehicles. So it just feels like there could be a better use. I wish I had a suggestion of a better use. I don't personally, but it does feel wasteful. And to the point of the congestion issues in the northern median lot, I'm there all the time. The congestion issues are not because of the gas station. It's just because of the poor circulation design, and there's not enough parking. So people end up parking in spots that are not for parking. The gas station, when I'm there, there's barely any cars there. It's not being used hardly at all. The Circle K gas station would likely be the same, because if people are not choosing to go to 7-Eleven and they're choosing to go to Chevron, for example, I doubt they're going to choose Circle K. Not a knock on Circle K, but just if they're not choosing 7-Eleven, they probably have a different preference, and maybe it's Chevron, which is right down the street. So we're really excited for this development, and you know, they made the point that the gas station is part of this, like, financially passing. So if that is true, then I, you know, as a resident, I'll take it. But I would like to see something that could benefit the community more. Also, there's so many kids in Inspirata, and we don't have anything for kids. So, like, that lot could be used for, I don't know, a small kids' play place, or, for example, a Chick-fil-A that has a play place or something. You know, like, there's nothing for kids. So that could be a potential use. And then I feel like I might have misheard this, but I think he said there's going to be a dental office in that lot. If that's the case, I disagree with that as well, but I know that's not, hasn't been presented as an item. We have a dental office in the lot, the northern median lot already. It's an adult dental office with a children's dental office right next to it. And then down the street, on volunteer. There's another West Henderson Dental Office down the street on St. Rose in the Costco parking lot, another dental office, and across the street from that, another dental office. So my time's up, but thank you.
Thank you.
And I appreciate the work there.
Thank you. Is there anybody else that would like to speak on this item? Seeing no one, I'll go ahead and close the public hearing. Commissioners?
Yes. I'd like to refer to part of the staff report from the City of Henderson, if I may. Can I do that?
Yep, absolutely.
End of page 3, top of page 4. They state, the concern with the parking of the fuel trucks to refill the underground tanks is that they would block the ingress and egress of the northeast exit of the site. The provided truck movements also will interfere with the proposed location of the fuel canopy. The city considers West Henderson to be a priority new growth area and is striving to guide development toward a balanced mix of land uses that support complete neighborhoods and healthy communities to better achieve long-term economy. That's it.
Thank you. Any other comments?
My comment was, in your presentation, you talked about Circle K having done a feasibility study. Did you, as the manager and developer, perform your own feasibility study?
We did not do any feasibility because we are developers. Our only obligation or contractual relationship with Circle K is a lease, that they pay the lease payment. So they have determined this is a location that makes sense for them, and they have signed the lease for that purpose. So we're not aware, and I mean, we know that they have done that study to sign a lease, but we did not do a study of our own.
What study did you do in order to present that lease to Circle K?
What study did we make?
Yeah, what presentation did you make to Circle K? Because you would have presented a feasibility study based on traffic count and number of rooftops.
We don't have those details. We're not privy to the study that they make. The only thing we get as a landlord is the fact that how much they're willing to pay, and they want the site. And this is one of their highest priority to get a location in that, because they have determined this is a good location for them. And again, in response to Councilwoman regarding the traffic, again, we have this pattern study done based on the engineering circulation and the radiuses. With all due respect to the staff, we still don't understand how that fueling the truck does in fact fit very easily between the fueling tank and the canopy, and in no shape or form they block the ingress, the egress, or the parking lane. Or the fire lanes.
Yeah, I went out and I looked at the site myself yesterday, and I was expecting to be overwhelmed by gas stations, but I really wasn't. It didn't seem like there was an abundance, an overabundance of gas stations near this project. I certainly saw the 7-Eleven. I saw it's a very dense project, and it looks like there's a lot of traffic, a lot of parking issues, and kind of intimidated me to go in there because I didn't know if I could get out. But I don't see those same types of issues with yours. The concern on the fueling trucks seems to be, I mean, you seem to have answered that. That makes sense to me, that, you know, there's a space for them to park and fuel without parking in the travel lane. So, I mean, that makes perfect sense. And as far as, I mean, I've done a lot of leasing, and I know that, you know, you rely on your tenant to do their own feasibility study.
Absolutely.
And to come back and say, we've looked at rooftops, we've looked at development, this is the place that we think we can make money as a gas station. I mean, as far as whether that's the highest and best use for the property for the needs of this area of Henderson, you know, I think the rest of the project brings something valuable to the city, particularly with the medical uses. So, I mean, sometimes you have to take the project as a whole, and if the Circle K makes the rest of the project work, I mean, maybe that's what you have to give up in order to get the entire project. So,
we appreciate that.
Thank you.
Also, I would like to point out that, as the staff report mentions, we have overparked the project. We have over required landscaping. We have provided over the required bicycle stalls. We've gone beyond our requirements to make this a pleasant environment and a project that welcomes the community to come, to park, to, we have a walkway which goes from the, all the way from the top north of us to the south of us through the project with a lot of landscaping and benches and other things to make this a community, an enhancement to the community.
I want to commend you on providing a visual because one of the concerns was the fuel truck. I think the staff's concern is, you know, if the fuel truck is stuck out in the traffic lanes because somebody else is trying to, you know, work their way through, now you've got a fuel truck out on a major road. That would be a concern of mine as well. I agree with Commissioner Grismanowskis on some of the points that staff made. Particularly, I feel like we need to look at some other solutions or options for that location, which meet the master plan and, you know, the city's vision of what they're looking for, what we're looking for in that area. So those are my concerns. Commissioners, any other comments or questions?
I guess I'd actually echo Commissioner Rice's comments of not sure what my dream of a density of gas stations was, but it doesn't feel like that's there. Like, I guess I'm used to seeing the corners where you have one on each corner and then one mid-block, and I didn't really feel that way on the site. And then, you know, maybe to clarify, do a little bit of retail as well. And typically there's some pretty strong data somewhere, some guy and or some person at Circle K has drilled in that there's this many potential Circle K users. And my understanding is there's people have a preference on Terrible Herbs, Circle K, whatever the choices are. You know, I guess like I like Chick-fil-A, or somebody likes Chick-fil-A, I like Five Guys better. But so to me, there, you know, so there's always that question of like, which is a winner and loser. And I don't, so I struggle a little bit with whether the city's, well, I guess one is what, whether their threshold of there's too many gas stations and my tolerance might be different. And so that's kind of a challenge I'm trying to deal with. So, but those are my comments.
Staff, I had a question. One of the comments that the applicant made was that the original application had 8 fueling points or 8 fueling positions, and that the staff recommended it be reduced to 6. Can you shed some light on that?
Yeah. So the recommendation, I think seeing the 8 fueling or the 8 pumps was the concern number one, and saying there are too many pumps. And then when they brought back in 6, we had a chance to look at it on a plan and still realized this is still too much. This still doesn't work. And so, yeah, in our negotiations with the applicant, which have been going on for months and months and months, they've done quite a bit of what we've asked them to do. It came to the realization that this was too much. This, even by reducing it to 6, still could not support the gas station. And again, it was, oh, go ahead.
Well, just to put a bow on what he said, the staff said that 8 was too much. We didn't say that 6 was the ideal number. We didn't give a number. It was just our feedback was that 8 was too many pumps.
The report says 6.
Thank you.
I have a quick question about this radius study. The radius study that you have in front of us, was this part of the original project? Was this part of the original application?
I beg your pardon, I did.
Radius study for the fuel trucks that you have in front of us, was this part of the original application, or was this presented more recently?
This project has always had the gas station as part of the project.
Not the gas station. The document sitting right in front of you on your right, it has the radius study, the turning radius study, the blue shaded area that shows.
Yes, as part of the package, a radius pattern was provided to the city.
So that's always been in there?
Yes.
It's not new information? Yeah.
Dave Turner, 89112.
This is the turning analysis that we submitted when we submitted the application. It's an audit turn analysis. It's done by different engineers. This one was done by Kimley Horn for Circle K to show that that works, and it's always been part of the application.
And also separately, the staff required us to do a full-scale traffic report, which we did prepare and was reviewed and approved by the staff for the entire project, including the gas station and all the traffic pattern of this project. That was commissioned already and provided and approved.
Okay, thank you. any other questions or comments?
One quick question for staff. The number of gas stations, is that based on, is the ratio based on the number of properties currently in the master plan, or what could be approved or for future use? Like, what, where is that based on, past, present, or future?
So are you referring to the exhibit that I showed? So that the master plan doesn't outright prohibit gas stations, but it encourages several primary uses and secondary uses, and gas stations are not one of them. So that's the concern. It's one of that three-pronged concern that we have. Is one is a proliferation of gas stations within the town center master plan area, which is a lot larger than this. This is just a small piece of that master plan. So there's already one, and then one within the master plan, and then the other four that we're shown are up on the same road via Inspirata.
Couple questions on the parking. You mentioned parking. You do have the McDonald's in the tenancy, you said, right?
Yes.
Okay. And then you have a tenant restaurant bar in D that you haven't filled, correct?
That one is not leased yet.
Okay.
It is designed and parked as a restaurant. We'll see who the ultimate user would be.
That's a proposed 5,000 square foot building?
Correct.
And then you have another restaurant of 3,500 square feet. Each and every one of these, every one of them is sharing 34 sites.
Let me make one correction. That building, the small 3,500 square feet shown as a restaurant, we've already have a signed letter of intent for an urgent care. So an urgent care would be going in there.
So what I'm getting at is you've got a tremendous amount of shared parking here and a McDonald's with traffic. And traffic at a McDonald's at most times is horrendous, which in your traffic pattern here, they're only going to be able to get into this one way unless they turn around in a parking lot. So you're putting a great package together and jeopardizing the whole thing because of a gas station. And I understand that that's probably your anchor, but at that point, is there anything else you can put in there as your anchor besides this? Because you've overwhelmed this site with too many things.
If you notice, the rest of the project is pretty much outside the scope of the gas station. It has very little to do. All the restaurants, medical, all the other users are south of it. Has nothing to do with the circulation of the gas station and the traffic of the gas station.
The traffic patterns and everything else will result in a mess, is what it's going to do. I'm just asking, is there anything else that you can put in here to anchor this to help this go forward? I'm not a fan of it because it's 2 minutes away from another gas station, and even Circle K will tell you they'll put one on each corner if they could. They don't care if it's going to make money. They all make money. So they'll put them on all four corners. So that don't fly too much with me. And I just don't see the fact that this wonderful project, this is a great project, you're going to jeopardize it because of a gas station.
It has taken us a little over 18 months to get to this point. Mm-hmm. Redesigning, implementing, improving the pattern, the traffic, the locations, the sizes based on the repeated staff's recommendation. And we strongly believe that this will be a successful project. We've done a number of other, we just completed another project with Circle K on Blue Diamond and Edmond just west of Decatur, and that has turned out to be the same thing there on one side, and the rest of the project is on the other side, and it is working greatly for them.
I can speak to that project, though, that there's not a gas station 2 minutes from it, and that's also not in a roundabout. It's also very different. I'm very familiar with that project, but I wouldn't use that as comparable.
Well, you know, the gas station is listed separate. It's on a separate boat. Are you aware of that?
I understand the staff has made it that way.
Correct.
But this has been submitted as one project.
So there's an emergency room, care facility, convenience store, restaurant, drive-through facility, all of those are listed separately. So even if the gas station needs to be rethought, we can vote for it separate from the rest of the area. If nobody has any more questions, I'd like to make a motion.
Okay, we'll take the conditional use permit separately from the rest of it because it's a recommendation on the staff, so.
Right, okay, it's confusing. Should we do the denial separate?
Yes, that's what I was just
saying. Okay, let's try that.
I do want to clarify one thing. So you are voting separate, right now as it's set up, you're voting separately on the gas station and then all the rest are one item. We can vote separate on every item if we need to. So it's not, we're not logging anything into blocking it into one group or another. Okay. If you would like to vote all separate, you have the choice to vote all separate.
I don't, does staff have any, or do you guys have any issues with putting the rest of them together?
We'll see how it goes.
Okay. Well, I make a motion to deny CUP 20230139 31.
There's a motion on the floor. Please vote.
To clarify, the question is,
well, we haven't finished.
If you agree to deny the gas station, you would vote yes.
You would vote yes if you agree with the denial. You would vote no if you did not agree with the denial.
I was just, sorry.
And the denial passes. So, Commissioner, did you want to continue on?
Okay, I'll make a motion to approve CUP 20230139 32, W0S 20240147 96, TMA 20230139 30, and DRA 20230139 34. Motion to approve.
Subject to findings of fact, conditions, and a waiver.
Yeah, sorry.
Okay. Motion on the floor. Please vote. That item passes. Thank you. Good luck with your project.
Thank you.
Appreciate your time.
Item number 22 is a conditional use permit request for a new massage establishment located at 229 North Stephanie Street, Unit D. Staff recommends approval of this request.
Applicant name and zip code for the record.
My name is Jin Liu. Zip code is A9002.
Do you agree with staff's recommendation of approval subject to the findings of fact and conditions?
Yes, I agree.
Okay.
This is my friend Cassandra. He came here to give me language support for if I need. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yeah, if you'll go ahead, since you're kind of helping her, if you state your name and zip code for the record.
Cassandra Hafen, 89015.
Thank you very much. With that, I'll go ahead and open the public hearing. Is there anyone here wishing to speak on this item? Seeing no one, I'll close the public hearing. Commissioners?
I'll motion for approval of CUP 20240145 46, subject to findings of fact and conditions.
There's a motion on the floor. Please vote. That item passes. Congratulations and good luck.
Thank you.
Item number 23 is a conditional use permit request for moving van truck rental in conjunction with an existing mini storage facility at 155 Pancho Villa Drive. Staff recommends approval of this request.
Hello, name and zip code for the record, please.
My name is Jason Thompson, 155 Pancho Villa, 89012. I'm here representing Epic Storage. We agree with staff's recommendations.
Thank you. Open the public hearing. Is there anyone here wishing to speak on this item? Seeing no one, I'll close the public hearing. Commissioners, I do have a question just for clarification. So the trucks will always be parked in those three storage bays, is that correct, other than when they're being used by a client?
Yes, that's the general idea.
Okay, so they won't be parked in any of the parking spots out front?
No.
Okay. Commissioners?
No, if no one has any comments, I'm happy to make a motion.
Okay.
I'll make a motion for approval of CUP 20240014593, subject to findings of facts and conditions.
There's a motion, please vote. That item passes.
Thank you.
Have a good night.
I'd like to thank the applicants for working with us on the code changes. Thank you.
Item 24 is a waiver request to reduce the front yard setback from 20 feet to 5 feet and corner side yard setback from 15 feet to 8 feet located at 200 South Parowan Street.
Name and zip code for the record, please.
Stephen Robb, 89015. I agree with staff's recommendation. I thank you for considering my request.
Great. Thank you very much. I'll open the public hearing. Is there anyone wishing to speak on this item? Seeing no one, I'll close the public hearing. Commissioners, comments, questions, or a motion?
I'll make a motion for approval. WOS 20240146-01, subject to findings of fact, conditions, and waiver.
There's a motion on the floor. Please vote. That item passes. Good luck.
Thank you. Have a good night.
Item 25 is a waiver request from the Development Code Standards to reduce the side yard setback from 5 feet to 3 feet located at 344 Ghana Street. Staff recommends approval.
Hi, name and zip code for the record. If you want to pull the mic down so it's closer to you, that'd be great.
Stacy Garcia, 89014.
Thank you. And so do you agree with staff's recommendation?
Yes, I do. Yes.
You do?
Yes.
Okay. Are you the applicant?
Yes, I am.
Okay. And so you agree with staff's recommendation?
With, I'm sorry, for an approval. I apologize.
Oh, okay. Their recommendation is denial.
Oh, okay.
So do you want to sell us on why it should not be denial?
Actually, on this one, this one's recommended.
Oh, am I on the wrong one?
Oh, okay. Sorry. That's what I thought I heard, too. So I'm like, okay. I don't know. I misheard.
Just on 25.
Make sure you're paying attention.
Yeah. I just wanted to make sure you're paying attention.
You're making me nervous is what you're doing.
Don't do that, Bill.
Okay. So you agree with staff's recommendation?
If it's an approval, yes.
Apologize for that.
It's okay.
I'll go ahead and open the public hearing. Is there anyone wishing to speak on this item? Seeing no one, I'll close the public hearing. Commissioners?
I'll motion for approval. You're welcome. WOS 20240146-26, subject to findings of fact and a condition.
There's a motion on the floor. Please vote. That item passes. Good luck, and I apologize for the confusion.
It's okay. Thank you again, guys.
All right, Mr. Chairman, our next item is item number 26. This applicant is requesting a waiver to reduce the side setback from 5 feet to 1 foot and to reduce the minimum distance separation between an accessory structure and a primary structure from 6 feet to 2 feet, 3 inches, located at 252 Hull Street. Mr. Adams will be providing a brief presentation on this item.
Staff?
Brian Adams, 240 Water Street. As Jared mentioned, this is a request for an accessory structure that is already there. Staff's recommending denial. The structure was built prior to, from what our understanding is, it was built prior to the homeowner moving in. Eventually, there was a neighbor complaint. It was cited by code enforcement, which has kind of led us to this point. Staff's recommending denial based on it being incompatible
architecturally with a primary home, and that is only 1 foot from the side property line with an adjacent home and 2 feet, 3 inches from the house. It also has been enclosed with a like a solid metal gate, which gives the appearance of like a 15-foot solid wall. So with that, I'll turn it over to the applicant.
Great, thank you. Name and zip code for the record, please.
Jacob Lyon, 89015. After 22 years in Las Vegas, my wife and I were able to purchase our forever home here in Henderson, so we are quite happy to be residents here now in Henderson. One of the deciding factors on this property purchase was the fact that it matches so many of the other properties in the neighborhood with RV structures, shade structures. It was a beautiful, not out of place with any other neighbor. Excuse me. Every single house has RV parking. Many of them have large RV garages or RV shade structures there. Excuse me. So it didn't seem anything out of the ordinary. It only became apparent to me that there was no permit pulled on it when it was built in 2015. We bought the house in October of 2021. I've spent our life savings in improving our property. Very proud of it. I've spent thousands and thousands of dollars on engineered testing, soils, wind shear, everything to make sure that it's a safe structure. You can drive up and down our street and see countless RV structures that are touching the homes, that are on the property lines, that are much larger than the one that, that we have. And so I beg you to give us our waiver so that I'm just trying to do this stuff legally after the fact. I was unaware that that it was done illegally to begin with, so I'm just trying to correct that. And it in no way is out of what's the word I'm looking for? It in a way stands out as like a sore thumb in the neighborhood. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. I'll go ahead and open the public hearing. I see that we've got some people wishing to speak on this item. I'll just need your name and zip code for the record, please.
Vicki Emerson, 89015.
You go ahead. You've got 3 minutes.
Okay. Yeah. The home next to us has, no, that goes over there. The home next to us has had and still does have a large RV cover. It was there when we moved. It actually appears to be inches away, not even a foot from our property line. It wasn't overly noticeable when the structure was a cover for the motorhome, because there are several motorhomes and RV parkings in the area where we live. But now the neighbors have chosen to enclose that whole area, so it's not open anymore. This area is huge. Our home actually looks dwarfed next to it, because the structure is now an enormous storage shed. Our lot setback on each side is from the house to, from the house to the structure is like 18 feet. So if you're out on the street and you look at this, you look at the structure, you would think because that's like right next to the property line. And so if you wanted to know what is our house and you're out on the street and you're looking at it, you say, oh, okay, half of that must belong to them and the other half must belong to us, which now diminishes by looks that our property is much smaller than their property is. And I'm not, their house is larger, but all of the lots are the same size. We don't have an HOA, so they didn't have to ask us for permission to enclose this. They have enclosed it all to make it like a storage shed. They didn't have to announce to us or anything, and that's fine. However, it would have been thoughtful if they would have. It's our understanding that there was no permit issued, as he stated, there was no permit issued, but neither he didn't get a permit to have that all turned into a storage shed either. And now with it being a storage shed, it's huge. It's just huge. It makes our house look small. You know, I realize that he has a problem with the not being told by the realtor, and I can sympathize, but certainly the realtor or the title company would have the address of the people who lived there before, and his issue would be with them. It shouldn't be with us. And our issue should, we shouldn't even have an issue with it because it's not supposed to be there. And it has affected, okay. Oh, thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I speak?
Just need your name and zip code for the record.
Carl Emerson, 89015. I'm her husband. Give me the pictures. I agree with all she says, and I just wanted to make a notation that this picture here, can you see this? Okay, that's the side, my house is right here.
These are in the garage.
The landscaping, the maintenance along that line has always been a little rough because you got to get behind these trees, and then you're rubbing up against his building, which is, I guess, 1 foot off the line is what they measured. Now, if it were the standard 5 foot off the line, then I'd have more room to control my maintenance. Other than that, this picture at night, that light's been set off automatically. But if the light's not on, that area there creates like a tunnel effect, and I figure it to be like unsecure. And I've got windows along this side here into the garage, so I don't figure it to be, you know, really a secure area because of that. There's not enough light getting in there. So whether or not, I appreciate your time, and we thank you.
Thank you. Looks like we have one more person wishing to speak. I just need your name and zip code for the record, please.
Jeffrey Fromm, 89015. First, I just wanted to give you some good feedback. I bought our house on Hull Street across the street from the applicant back in 2015, October. And I got to tell you, it's got to be one of our best decisions ever. We've moved all over the U.S. and lived internationally. But Henderson is a great place. And the Planning Commission, you guys, the Lee Family Forum, America First Center, the Raiders facilities, you guys taking care of that Fiesta Casino land and bringing it back and repurposing it for the city. They're home runs and just continue to be a big fan of Henderson. In addition, when we bought our house, it was brand new. It's on a third of an acre. So the entire lot was dirt. We established a budget of about $175,000 for landscaping, you know, pool, pergola, a lot of different things. It's beautiful. But all along the way, the planning department and the development codes kept our project on a great path. I know when we went for the plan approval, there were some changes we needed to make for a wall that had to be structural. And anytime we needed an inspection, the inspectors were right there. And now 8 years later, we have the most beautiful backyard. It survives all the windstorms and everything. So I'm a big believer in Henderson, the Planning Commission, and the development codes. Having said that, though, this structure that's in discussion right now was built when the neighbors moved in, and certainly was under construction when I moved in. In fact, that's how I met the neighbor. His name was Dave. He was a general contractor, and I'm a retired manufacturing executive. And one of the things I noticed is when the welder was welding it, he had all the right PPE equipment on. The job was well organized and safe, and this guy knew what he was doing when he built it. It's a beautiful structure, and when we built our house, the builder offered us the option of a 70-foot high RV garage, which we just couldn't take at the time. I think it was 70. The neighbors next door to us have this 70-foot high RV garage, and it looks great, but it, you know, this thing here looks awesome, and you know, it being a foot away from the edge of the property, you know, essentially it's two big steel poles that are holding the whole thing up. And the 6 feet to 2 feet variance, again, from the house, it's really the two big steel beam poles. So it's not like it's a walled structure or anything like that. If there's any emergency response that's needed, you know, they can get in and all that. Our house is beautiful. You guys just did a major roadwork upgrade on Warm Springs between Lake Mead Boulevard or Lake Mead Parkway and racetrack. The whole area looks great. You repaved our street. Please don't make this guy tear it down. The street looks awesome with it. It's going to look worse without it. What's the end game? You say no, and then he has to tear it down? It doesn't make sense. It just doesn't make sense.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
I would like to ask the neighbors to the adjacent a question. If I could ask them to come back up since we're still in the public hearing portion. So what changed? How long have you lived there?
Almost 5 years.
Okay. Were you opposed to the structure before the fencing went up?
No.
No. So it's the fencing that has caused the problem.
It now looks like a big storage shed, and that is what it is.
And if the fencing or the grading came down, would you still be opposed to it?
No.
Okay. All right.
That's what it looked like when we moved there. And like I said...
when we moved in, it was like a post and beam. Now it's... They put metal screening, almost solid, except for like punch metal, down the sides and the front with a big swing open door.
It just makes it look twice as big as it was before. I realize it doesn't, but it's just, it's all enclosed now. And yes, the people who did it did a good job, with the exception of cutting down a big branch of our tree. And they did do a good job with it, but it's a storage shed. Our house sits back from their property. And so the first thing you see, whether you're out in the street or you're coming out the door, is a big storage shed that's like, I don't know, 30 feet high. And this thing, it's just enormous. And you don't really pay much attention to it when it's an RV park, shelter.
Bill, your original question was, if it's the screen's gone, it's okay.
I appreciate.
I can sympathize. Believe me.
There's no motorhome in it. There's no trailer in it. There's no anything other than just, you know, small little trailers, personal ATV, whatever.
Thank you.
I said, if he would have come to us and asked us, he didn't have to. But if he would have, we could have discussed it at that time.
Fine. Thank you very much.
The main thing is it's like 1 foot off the line, and it should be like 5. Is the setback for an accessory building. But it's almost like right on the line. I mean, you can't...
I understand. All right.
You know,
thank
if
you
we get
much.
The back and you look down, it's nothing but... You know.
Thank you very much.
And okay. Even the back, in the backyard, when you look at it, it's... Whatever.
Great, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Unless anybody else has any questions, I'm going to go ahead and close the public hearing. Okay, thank you.
But our voters... to oppose the waiver.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Commissioners, any questions of the applicant, comments? You can come back up if you'd like.
I'll ask the question, is it okay? And I think I need to ask staff first, because it wasn't permitted to begin with. Does it have to come down? Or can it go back to the way he bought the house?
So, the structure itself would still need to be permitted regardless. If it's approved in any form, you would still need to go to the building department to obtain permits for the structure.
Yeah, I've worked with the building department for months and months, and they suggested coming this route.
I can't hear you.
I've worked with the building department for months and months on this, and they suggested coming and getting a waiver first, because again, that was months later before they even said anything about a waiver, because setbacks weren't even talked about. It was just a matter of, I found out that there was no permit on it, came to the building department, started that whole process, and have gone to great expense to have engineered plans, drawings, and just to give you a scope, it's 15 feet tall, it's 12 and a half feet wide, and it's 40 foot deep. It's the same size as every other RV structure on the street. It's enough to park an RV in. There was an RV that was there when we bought the house. We don't own an RV at the moment. I'm not retired yet, but that is part of the forever home plan, was to have an RV, and I don't want to park an expensive RV exposed when virtually outside of one, every other RV structure is completely enclosed. This has got screens so you can still see through it, and it's got a gate that was put on the front so that I have some ability to have security.
I did drive the neighborhood, and I see that, and that happens everywhere that has half acres, one acres.
I mean, that's one of the reasons that we bought that particular.
My question is you're here for a waiver.
Correct.
Okay. Now, that waiver would entail you taking the screen off, I think, and then possibly getting it that way.
Okay.
If you don't want to take the screen down, I think your waiver is going to be denied. But well, I'm just.
I'm with you. I mean, guys, I just want to do it legally. Again, I've spent $11,000 to screen it. It's not cheap. It wasn't done poorly. It was done by a professional iron company to match the rest of the structure at great expense to us. I included letters from all the other neighbors outside of the one here, and everybody else said, it's beautiful, we love it, we are quite jealous of it, we wish that we had one exactly like it, or that the one that we have was more like that one. So, I mean, I find myself in company with probably all my other neighbors. Maybe they didn't know they had to have a permit for these structures as well, but I would imagine that none of them are. I'm not trying to get anybody in trouble. So it never would have entered my mind we were going through the process of buying this home and or putting the screen up to add some security for our future purchase. No different than having a garage that closes. I don't go home and leave my garage door open with my car and belongings in there. I have some things that I would like to make sure couldn't get messed with by a neighborhood kid or whatever the case may be, you know. So and it talks about the building department. That was also brought up the screen. So we had wind shear testing, stamped engineered plans to say that the structure is completely safe. It meets building codes. It's just a matter of setback. And the building department says you're good to go.
I have a question. So you're asking the city of Henderson to change the one setback from 5 feet to 1 foot, is that correct?
Correct.
And then the other setback from 6 feet to 2.3 inches?
Correct.
Is that correct?
Correct. So I haven't made any change to the size of the structure at all. I'm asking for a waiver so that the building department can then say, yes, you can keep it, or no, it's got to go. We all moved into a neighborhood that has no HOA, so we don't have to get permission from our neighbors to have something done. It's within it's the same size as everybody else's RV structure or smaller. So I'm looking for a waiver so that if the building department says nope, it's got to go, your plans, your engineered plans say the screen has to come down, no problem. However, I've already proven to that, had the engineered plans done. I'm just looking for the waiver that says, yes, you can have your structure like all your other neighbors have. And I'm not trying to make my neighbors upset. Every other neighbor that looks at it all day, every day. I've included letters for you guys. You should have seen those that say, hey, we love it. One of my neighbors unexpectedly came down to show support today. I wasn't expecting to see Jeff show up. And he came in and said, I just got back from vacation, saw the notice in the mail, and I'm coming down. Because we believe that it is a very, very beautiful structure for all the homes.
We're glad it's a beautiful structure. That's wonderful. You think it's fair to them?
The complaint, when code complaint showed up, they said that I was running a legal business out of my house and I was dumping sewage illegally. That's how code compliance showed up in the first place, because they made a complaint. I had an elderly couple in our church that whose home flooded last December, I guess it would have been. They had their little travel trailer that we said, you know what, go ahead and bring it by. You can park it in there while we're getting your house deflooded. A couple of weeks later, code compliance showed up and said, they're here illegally. They are dumping sewage. Every single one of us, them included, we all have RV parking with full hookups that came from the builder when the homes were built. We were trying to do a good thing. No good deed goes unpunished. Otherwise, there would never have been a comment about it ever. We've spent a ton of money updating our home. We let them use our rented trash receptacles to dump their garbage in when we had them out there several times during renovations of flooring and things like that. I thought we had a great relationship going on. They never one time came next door and knocked on my door and said, hey, Jake, what's going on? They just called code compliance and said that you're breaking the law. And there was no mention whatsoever about a complaint of the RV shade cover that had been there for 10 years now.
Staff, I still want to clarify the fact that if it's denied, it comes down, correct?
It won't be able to be permitted in its current design, even whether it was a screen or not. The structure cannot be permitted.
So if the waiver's given and he takes the screen down, is it still not permitted?
Then he'd be able to work with the building department to complete the building permit process.
So he could keep it without the screen?
As long as the building department signed off on the permit, yep.
From a planning perspective, concerns still exist. If the planning commission has the discretion to make a motion that it would approve it with the screen coming down, that's at your discretion
That's what I'm trying to get to, right. Mr. Lyon here.
I agree.
If we deny the waiver,
yes,
you're possibly taking it down.
Correct.
But if we...
So my question to you guys then is, if the building department says the screen is no problem...
That's not going to happen. I can see that happening already from what building department's done with you.
Okay.
So what's going to happen is if we deny the waiver, it's going to be illegal.
Right. No. But so if the building department says, hey, you got to take the screen off of it, then so be it.
So if we make a motion to approve and the screen comes down, you're good with that?
I am good with that.
They seem to be good with that, correct?
Are they?
Yeah.
Are you?
Yes, they are. They've already said
that. We already established that. Okay. Yes.
So can we do that?
I think.
I guess I had one question that may be ridiculous, but is there some kind of compromise to decorate appropriate? I mean, I could see that as kind of a, if you were looking at it all day, that probably is not, like, I don't know that your neighbor was dreaming of a mural on it necessarily. Is there any kind of thought on how to, like, decorate it? Like,
I walk my dogs. I walk my dog every day, and as I'm walking back towards my house, they have got three or four large trees that block the view of it to begin with. So them saying that they stare at the size of this building, you can't see it through the trees. The trees are there, and it blocks the view.
Well, I mean, they showed a picture and all of, I think we've established there are some trees. They're not really like the densest trees I've ever seen, but so I was just kind of like.
No, I'm with you.
I don't know that we want to go into design workshop here, but I wonder if there's something that they might like to look at versus not, but I don't know that we really have the appetite to do a design workshop in this hour right now. So I'll go ahead and let someone else make comments.
Commissioner Beeson, did you want to make a stab at it with a condition?
Yeah, I would make a motion to approve with the condition that the screening comes off and goes back to the way you bought it when you bought the house.
Okay.
So if you can live with that and they can live with that, that's something that we could probably move forward on and make that motion.
Okay.
Is that good?
Yeah.
Commissioner Beeson, can I make one
point
of clarification? So there is no side property line wall at all. And code would allow up to a 6-foot wall along that entire side property line. So yep. I just want to clarify, screen coming down, are we saying down to the point of where a side property wall would come to, or is it, because
so
if the screen gets removed, they'd still be able to get a permit for a wall on that side property line.
So I understand once you go to building and they work with you, you can possibly do that.
So kind of my question then, so could I continue the CMU block wall all the way to the front? I mean, in theory...
Building department.
Correct, but I mean, I see the other neighbors, they've all had, not all, but plenty have had walls that come all the way to the front, because I still want to be able to gate off my side yard there, like I have on the other side, and like all my neighbors have. They're the only ones who don't have a gated side yard. Everybody else on the street has got walls that come out, gates in the front. That's why
I think what we're trying to say, though, that's not up to us. We're not here to develop or go over a design review with you.
Right.
What Commissioner Beeson, what his motion was going to be was, and what staff is trying to say, when you use the word down, are you saying all the way remove? And so Commissioner Beeson is saying remove it to the original condition.
Correct.
So it's not really using the word down. It's restore to original condition that you did upon purchase.
Yeah, understood.
And just another option is a possible, the idea of doing a continuum so he can work out all these issues and kind of look into the block wall. To kind of determine that way, it would give him a month to come back to this board.
Would you like to do that?
That would be fine. That would be fine with me as well.
I will make a motion for this to be continued until staff, is 30 days enough next month? until next month's meeting. I'll make that motion.
So then I would go to the building department again and see what requirements they would have, and say that I've talked, the hearing here so far says there's a thought of approval for a waiver, as long as we are able to work this stuff out with
we can work with you. If we the vote to a continuance, Mr. Adams here can meet with you outside and clarify the process.
Yeah.
But generally speaking, what you would do is you would, as soon as you can, start meeting with the building department to get an understanding of what you would have to do to put in a block wall. Okay. And we could probably then clarify a little more, because I'm looking at the Google Street View from April of 22 of what it looked like before.
Right.
And so I think that that's where staff can work with you on what the expectation is. So when we come back to this board and we do briefings with them, and we'll, you know, explain to them kind of where what's happened in the last month to kind of get us to this point.
Gotcha.
So
okay.
That's something that we could trade contact information, and we can work with you starting on Monday.
Oh, that'd be
kind
perfect.
Of hit the ground running, and we'll staff, be back in front of here in July.
Staff, I have a question though. If we approve this with the condition that Commissioner Beeson had stated, they can still apply for a block wall. Is that correct?
Absolutely. I'm just
trying to understand, why would we want to continue it?
Well, I think he needs to understand the parameters of what he can do with the block wall, because he can do a block wall, but I don't believe it can come all the way up to the street frontage. And so the continuance, at my suggestion, and this is your discretion and the applicant's discretion, is to hash out all of these issues that we haven't completely seemingly hashed out at this point. So that's, and again, I'm just making, just throwing out an option for you. I'm not trying to lead you in any direction. I just want to make sure that you understand that that's another option that you have. If we do need some clarity, it seems like we can work out these issues.
My general feeling is that, is staff going to come back and recommend approval based upon those changes, given the fact that they're still in violation of code?
We would have to review it in the state of which the proposal is. So it's hard for, I can't give you a recommendation on the spot without reviewing exactly what he would be doing with this proposal. And so that's part of what we would work out in this time being. So it's impossible for us to give you what our recommendation would be based on what we don't see in front of us. So we would need to see some plans and have some conversations before we can give you a recommendation.
Thank you. So there's a motion on the floor for continuance to next month's meeting. All those in favor, please vote.
It's not a motion to approve.
No,
it's a motion continue. To continue.
The motion is to continue to next month's meeting. So you'd be... If you agree with that motion, then you want to vote yes.
Motion. It's a motion to continue, right?
Motion's continue.
Okay.
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 And that motion passes for continuance.
We'll see you next
work
month.
With your neighbors, figure out a solution, and hopefully we'll have it solved for next meeting.
Thank you guys very
Thank
much.
Thank you.
Item number 27 is a master sign plan with modifications from the downtown master plan to A, increase the square footage of a projecting blade sign from 8 square feet to 106 square feet, and B, increase the total square footage of a wall sign on the east elevation of the building from 90 square feet to 114 square feet, located at 150 South Water Street. Staff recommends approval.
Name and zip code for the record, please.
Good evening. Bobby Pucci with Vision Sign 89113. We appreciate staff's recommendation, and I'm here to answer any questions you may have.
Great, thank you. I'll open the public hearing. Is there anyone who wishes to speak on this item? Seeing no one, I'll close the public hearing. Commissioners.
I would like to ask, who did you make mad that you're the last one on the agenda?
Sorry, I couldn't hear that. On the last
you sat
agenda,
here quietly the whole meeting. You're the last guy in the room. Who did you?
I just want to hang out with you guys.
Okay, I appreciate that.
Good choice. Thank you.
If there's no questions, or I'll make a motion to approve MSP 202-401-4599, subject to conditions.
There's a motion on the floor. Please vote. That item passes. Good luck with that. Thank you.
Thank you. Have a great night.
Oh, there's got to be something else.
No, there's not.
I don't know. It's loud.
Is that the last item, staff?
Sure we didn't miss something?
All right. This brings us to the public comment portion of the meeting. Items discussed under public comment cannot be acted upon at this meeting. Is there anyone here wishing to address the commission? Seeing no one, I'll close the public comment. Now I'll open it up for comments for...
I have a comment.
Okay.
I cannot imagine in my wildest dreams this commission approving a setback to 1 foot. I just can't. I mean, you guys, the precedent we would set with something like that. I realize the circumstances, but and I think you guys, we did the right thing by continuing it.
Okay.
So,
staff, do you have any comments? Andy, you're usually pretty good about making comments at the end of the meeting.
Oh, we just appreciate all the time that you spend kind of coming to briefings and working with us on these agenda items. We continue to appreciate all the effort. Thank you.
Thank you.
And I will say that, Sherry, I'm sorry to say that we didn't get you out of that here in an hour and 20 minutes as you had projected, but it's all good. We have more people here. I think Commissioner Lewis did. I'll go ahead and... adjourn. Thank you. Had to get to the word. Have a good evening, everybody.